Learn Excel from Mr. Excel podcast, episode 1846, Gavin Jordan, confidence chart without a pivot table.
All right. Hey, welcome back to the Mr. Excel Netcast. I'm Bill Jelen. We're here in New York City with Gavin Jordan from London, right?
Hi. Yeah.
Hey, Gavin's one of the 16 finalists in ModelOff 2013, the World Excel Championships. Gavin, what are you going to show us today?
So I'm going to show you how to make a pretty version of a confidence chart. So this is a chart that shows over time the likelihood of a result ending up within a particular confidence. So what might be the minimum, maximum, and the average in the future? As we can see from the base data here, if you just chart these as a line graph, not very exciting, not very clear.
Right, yeah. All right, so we have this ugly chart.
Yeah, so I'm going to show you how to turn that into an area chart like this, where the light gray area shows that there's a 95% chance of the values in the future year fitting within that light gray area.
Right.
And the dark gray area, there's a 50% chance of the values fitting within that.
And then the dark line is the...
And the dark line is the average expected in this scenario over the next 10 years.
So this chart is just horrible. I can't figure out what the heck is going on. But this chart makes it very clear what the expected range is. And it's wild how it gets wider as time goes by. I guess that's less...
Yeah, so as you're projecting out into the future, you're going to have less confidence as to where your outcome is going to be.
Well, this chart is a lot better looking than the first chart. I would love to figure out how to create this. Why don't you take us through step by step?
Yeah, let me show you.
Okay.
So the first thing I've done is I've manipulated the data just a little bit from the table that we have up here. So the minimum column just stays as it was before. So as you can see, this is just linked directly to the cells above.
So it's just a straight formula, equals C2, C3, C4, C5.
Just gotcha. Straightforward, linked to exactly the cells
above. Perfect, gotcha.
The low is the bit of the stack that's on top of the minimum. So here, it's the difference between the low numbers that we had here and the minimum numbers.
So 154 minus 136 there.
Exactly. Right. So the formula, very simple, D2 minus C2,
perfect.
D3 minus C3.
Gotcha, okay.
So the difference is between. The mean, we're going to do something different with. We're going to put that as a line chart, so we just leave that as it is before. So
straight,
we're going to superimpose that on the stack.
Gotcha, okay.
The high, in a similar way to the low, is now the difference between the bit that's stacked on top of the low. So this is the difference between the high and the low from up above. So the difference between the 120 and the 102.
Yeah.
So F2 minus F3 minus D3 for the second one. So.
Yep, good. That's good.
And the max, same again. How much of the stack is going to go on top of the high? So the difference between the max and the high column.
So hey, just to interject here, this is a little bit tricky because you can't really copy those formulas across. I guess C and E are the exact same formula, but all of the other formulas you're comparing two columns that aren't necessarily adjacent.
Absolutely right. I mean, what you might want to do if you've got lots of different intervals is everything up to the mean and the ones on the other side of the mean are okay, but you just need to get that mean one slightly
different. Careful.
So you could start with the low, copy them across, and then replace the replace the mean.
Okay, great. So now let's see how we take this data.
So
and make
if
it
we
into
chart
a
this now, it's not going to look great to start with, but we'll get there.
I love those tricks where it looks like you're going the wrong way, and then all of a sudden it snaps back. Okay.
So we're going to chart this as a stacked area chart.
Stacked area. Okay.
Okay. So.
Okay.
Not quite what we were looking for. But it will get there. So the first thing we need to do is take the mean, and we're going to change that to a line.
So you right-click, change chart.
And to a line chart.
Just regular, it doesn't matter whether it's stacked or just regular
line chart.
Gotcha.
Regular line chart.
Okay, great.
So now we can start to see that coming in the middle.
It's starting to come into play, all right.
Now the next thing we need to do is we need to remove the color for the minimum.
All right.
And change the other colors as well. So we're going to change the colors now to make this look good. First thing we're going to do is we're going to take the minimum and we're going to remove the color there. So we go up to Format, up to Shape Fill, and No Fill.
There we go, okay.
So that takes that piece out. So we're going to color in light gray the areas that sit within the 95% confidence. So these outer ones here.
Okay.
So the blue and the red. So we're going to color those into, again, up to Format, Shape Fill, and into the second light gray there.
Second light gray, okay.
And then let's do the same again on the red, and Shape Fill, and the second light gray. Starting to come together now.
Nice.
We could change the color of the middle if we want, but probably dark gray is fine.
Yep.
And then we now just have to select the mean.
Yep, there we go.
And let's change.
Now that's shape outline.
That shape outline is it's a line, not an area, and we change that to black.
Now we still have that legend on the right hand side that looks ugly. Max, high, low, min, mean. I'm not really sure that does anything. What do you do with the legend?
So I normally take the legend. I normally take the legend out. I just select it and delete it. And then I'll often just put some labels in below to explain, or perhaps a paragraph explaining below. These are charts that some people will be very familiar with, but for others, there'll be something, something new.
That's a cool-looking chart. I certainly, if I had my choice between the first chart that you showed and this chart, this explains it a lot better. So, yeah, right. Very nice.
And you can do this with as many columns as you want. So you might have a 50%, a 90%, and a 95% confidence interval. Again, shades of gray.
Now, of course, you use this in financial modeling a lot. I mentioned, our place down in Florida, we're always watching the hurricanes come in, and they have the same kind of track. This is where we think it's going to hit, but there's a 10%, 20%, 30% chance. It's like that hurricane cone chart.
Absolutely.
Yeah, right.
A practical example of where we sit. So, I'll use it projecting investment returns or other forms of finance into the future over 1 year or 2 years. We've got a lot more confidence. We know that for 2015, we know that there's a 95% confidence that we'll be within this little band here. By the time we go out to 2036, it's a much wider band.
Wow, that is a great chart. That is very good. And I want to point out that when Gavin sat down to do the podcast, he said that clearly he should be doing a pivot table podcast because that's his thing. But we didn't have the right data for that. So for all of Gavin's coworkers, yes. This should have been a pivot table.
And keep asking me pivot table questions. I can't answer them, but you got something different today, guys.
There you go. All right, that's great. All right, Gavin, good luck in the ModelOff Championships. Thanks for being here in New York City.
Thank you very much, Bill.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gavin. All right, hey, I want to thank you for stopping by. We'll see you next time for another Netcast. Mr. Excel.